Mark chapter 5. We're looking at the continuation of an episode that's a miracle within a miracle. Look at verses 20-21 and following. If you have that in your Bibles, please stand if you found that. And if you don't have a Bible with you, we've got it on the screen for you. What a wonderful passage this is. Because we want to think today about how the miracles of Jesus are evidence of his mercy. Yes, they're evidence of his power, no doubt about that. But his mercy, there's a sense in which he cannot help but act compassionately. Oh, that that were more of us. As we think about it, and we begin to read this passage in a few moments, I want you to know that when Jesus, the way Mark portrays him for us, while Jesus is fixed and focused on the cross, he is never too busy to stop and show mercy. And I think if you read the Gospels honestly, you realize that he would say that to us. Be fixed on the mission, but never be too busy to stop and show mercy. Because there's a sense in which that really is endemic to the mission. I want you, as we study this, to feel in a new and fresh way today that we are the recipient of sovereign, compassionate mercy. And as we leave here, for the purpose to do, be doers of the word, not hearers only, as we leave here, I hope that you'll be more committed to advancing the gospel, the Great Commission, through disciple making, realizing that one of the primary paths in that, and to do that, to accomplish that, is showing tenderness to those around us who could use a healthy dose of mercy. Let's read the passage. If you'll follow along as I read this. Mark 5, 21-43. He had crossed again in the boat to the other side. A great crowd gathered about him, and he was beside the sea. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and seeing him, he fell at his feet and implored him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and alive." And he went with him, and a great crowd followed him and thronged about him. And there was a woman who had had a discharge of blood for 12 years, who had suffered much under many physicians and had spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. She'd heard the reports about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, "If I touch even his garments, I will be made well." And immediately the flow of blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Jesus, perceiving in himself that power had gone out from him, immediately turned, "Who touched my garments?" His disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. Be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Do not fear. Only believe." And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John and the brother of James. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and Jesus saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he entered, he said to them, "Why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha kumi," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." And immediately the girl got up and began walking, for she was 12 years of age. And they were immediately overcome with amazement. And he strictly charged them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. This is the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient Word of God. And all this passage is so packed with food and nourishment that we need in times like these. May the Lord help us to feed upon the Word today and be fed by it and nourished, strengthened to go from this place to do what He's taught us. Thank you. Be seated. Well, this, you recall, we said a couple weeks ago, this happens on the heels of the healing of the demoniac from Gerasa. Remember, he healed the demoniac and he cast all the demons into these pigs who ran into the lake, and they want him to leave the area. You're too costly for business. We can't sustain ourselves if this keeps up. And so he got back in the boat, even though he had just come across. When he was coming across, remember the first time, that's when the storm broke out and he was asleep in the boat and the disciples were afraid they were going to perish. So we've seen this compassion to those afraid of the seas and the weather, compassion to one who was crazy, out of his mind. When he encounters Jesus and experiences the compassion of Jesus, he's found seated, clothed in his right mind at the feet of Jesus, ready to learn, ready to serve, ready to. And then we looked at this passage 3 weeks ago. And we see this leader coming to him, Jairus, begging him. On the way, he heals a woman by the simple reaching out and touching his garment. Oh, if I can just touch the hem of the garment, I can be healed. What faith. It's not an accident that this happened. In fact, I believe Jesus uses the occasion to heal this woman and then to say to Jairus, just believe. Don't grieve. Believe. Jairus, standing there, had just seen this woman come and throw herself down at Jesus' feet and tell what had happened. Heard Jesus' response, woman, your faith has made you well. Now let's go ahead right now. This has been abused over and over and over again. There's a whole segment of Christianity that lives and breathes on passages like this to take them beyond what they will bear. You know that and I know that. But brothers and sisters, our evangelical response should not be to run from their ditch into another ditch. We need to stay on the path of the evangelical truth. Jesus is sovereign, powerful. He is merciful. He is compassionate. And hold that up and rejoice in that. And get rid of our yes, but discussions on theology. So I want us to see today some things. We've already looked at parts of this, like first of all, that Jesus departs from the area of the Decapolis, and second, that a prominent Jew casts himself at the mercy of Jesus. Third, a desperate woman dares to touch Jesus. And Jesus makes the connection between faith and wholeness with her. Your faith has made you whole. And pick up today in verse 35. And we'll go through the rest of these things. In verse 35, we have this bad news that comes. Put yourself there. You're part of the crowd. Following him. What's he going to do next? Maybe we can get a meal out of this. His power touches this woman who reaches out to touch the hem of his garment. And wherever you are in the crowd, you pick up this, what's going on here. This woman's healed? Yes. Your faith has made you whole, woman. That's what they hear him say. Then they come, while Jesus is still speaking, because he's teaching some things about the reality of this. There came from the ruler's house some who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" We've all received bad news, what we call bad news. Maybe a relative has suddenly died. We got word yesterday that some friends of ours, a young man that I watched grow up in youth camps, living in the Oklahoma City area, 3 months ago, almost 28 years old, 3 months ago, took his own life. A parent hearing that, discovering that. Perhaps you've gone to the doctor and the doctor has said it's not good. What our tests have found is not good. You've heard the word cancer. You've been told that something doesn't happen, your heart cannot handle who you are. My father experienced 3 massive heart attacks in my life, and 2 of them while I was still young. A doctor said to us at one point when I'd grown, sat down with a family consultation, he said, the major muscle in your dad's heart is about the thickness of the sheet of a paper, piece of paper, about that thick. The next episode he has will take his life. We got the news that my dear mother had cancer. We all, if we're going to live in this life, we're going to have trouble. Bad news is going to come. And it comes to this man who's just seen Jesus pronounce healing in a woman. Not because he sought her out, but because she sought him out. She threw herself at his feet, just like Jairus had thrown himself at Jesus' feet. There he is, hopeful. "Come, come, teacher. My daughter is very ill. Come and lay your hands on her and she will be well." Here's a man's testimony of faith that I know if you get to her in time and you decide to heal her, she'll be healed. I know that. The woman knew that. Then comes the word, she's dead. And now Jairus, whose faith extended to the possibility of Jesus healing his sick daughter, raising her up from the bed of her affliction, it did not come into his mind that he would bring her back from the dead. So we see in the 6th place Jesus' exhortation to believe and not fear. Look, verse 36. "But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, 'Do not fear, only believe.'" Brothers and sisters, that ought to be emblazoned upon our minds. It ought to be memorized by us. We ought to say it to one another every day. We ought to say it to ourselves in a mirror every day. Do not fear, only believe. Jairus, at a crossroads here. He could have said, "Teacher, I don't want to trouble you anymore. But I do appreciate your willingness to come to heal my daughter. I appreciate so much the fact that you were willing to do that." And that's probably what he would have said had Jesus not spoken up over the folks who came to him and said, "Your daughter is dead. Don't bother the teacher anymore. It will do no good for him to come now because she has passed from this life." Yet Jesus challenges Jairus, and I believe he would challenge you and me too. We have a tendency to fear. I saw an acrostic recently. What fear is. Fear is false evidence appearing real. Fear. We all deal with it. It is evoked by different circumstances in our lives. Jesus says, stop fearing. Believe. So he puts it at odds, this idea of fearing and faith. That's why we talk about fighting the fight of faith. When life comes at us with withering winds, blistering providences, things we had not expected, had not anticipated, we stand at that crossroads. Will I fear or will I believe? Will I give in to the fear that is sort of the natural response that remains from Adam's fall, who our first parents who had adored the opportunity to fellowship with their Creator in the garden, when they hear his voice after they've sinned, they fear. Will I do that? Or will I remind myself that no matter what providence I am expressing, and that's what Psalm 136 is, it's just filled with testimony of God's actions and his character, or will I believe his steadfast love endures forever? And this providence will not be an exception to that. However, whatever comes from it, through it all, I can be confident that in this, his steadfast love endures forever. So they make the trip to Jesus' house, verses 37 to 40. He gets to the house. He allows no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. So Peter and the sons of thunder are allowed into the house. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and Jesus saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. And that's interesting at this point. Some commentators believe that, and there was this practice, by the way, that when you had a death in your family, if you were wealthy, if you were well off, you could actually pay mourners, and they would just weep and wail and sigh and sob. So they were getting paid for it. Some commentators believe that's what's going on here. But it could have been genuine grief that a 12-year-old is cut down before the prime of her life. Whatever's going on there, Mark describes it as Peter had described it to him. Jesus saw a commotion. Fear unchecked leads to grief. Fear not submitted to the Savior, not given over to God to make faith out of it, that will lead to grief, to despair, disappointment. They're weeping and they're wailing loudly here. And when he had entered, he said to them, why are you making a commotion and weeping? Now, at this point you wonder, were they aware? And probably so. That Jairus was not there. He was not at the side of his bedside of his daughter when she died, because Jairus had gone to find the teacher, this Jesus of Nazareth, that they're hearing things about him, that he performs miracles. He heals people. He's healed all kinds of diseases. So given that they knew that, they too ignore. They've gone to fear. No one in that crowd is saying, well, wait though. If the Master is coming, it's going to be okay. If Jesus is coming, it's going to be okay. That wasn't the attitude of the crowd. Rather, someone in that household said, go tell Jairus. Talitha's dead. Go tell him. Maybe you'll catch him before he's caught up to the preacher or the teacher. Just go tell him. It's too late. It's too late. I read an article 2 weeks ago, I think, about a woman who the family had been summoned around her bedside to make the decision, that difficult decision that families come to from time to time, to take away the life support mechanisms, preparing for her to die. Say your last regards to this loved one. And they did. They took out the breathing apparatus, and her heart was beating on its own, and she revived. Years ago, when I was young in the ministry, I was still in my 20s, I went to visit a young man who had some real bad seizures. He was having these grand mal seizures, and they were just tearing him apart physically. And so they took him to the hospital, and they sedated him so much that he went into a coma. And he stayed in a coma. He was in a coma for, I think I visited him over the course of 6 months or so. Family wrestling with, should we take away the breathing apparatus? And the doctor said, well, that's your decision. All of his vitals are good. He's just not coming out of the coma. And then one day he sat up in bed and said, where am I? As if nothing had ever happened. See, folks, while we're going to grant that some people abuse this idea of just believe and all these good things are going to happen, someone else's abuse of a truth should not be met with our disuse of a truth. We are quick to give up too many times, quick to go to despair many times, quick to abandon what we know in our minds to be true. Do not fear, only believe. Jesus says, why are you making this commotion? The child is not dead, but sleeping. Now they laughed at him. Let's grant some leeway to them. The mom had just come out some hours earlier and said she's gone. Her heart had stopped beating. No breath is coming from her lifeless body. So for Jesus initially to come in and say, don't be weeping and carrying on. The child is not dead but sleeping. But you see, he was not mistaken. He was describing the condition of anyone that he encounters. For Jesus, the dead simply sleep. And if it's his desire to raise them from the dead, they will come out of sleep of death. You can't read this without remembering Lazarus, whom he loves so much. His sister saying, but Master, he's been dead 3 days. There's probably decay that's already occurring in there. Remove the stone. Lazarus, come forth. So let's give some leeway to these folks who laughed at him. Initially, you want to read that and go, how dare you laugh at him? Because two sisters of arguably the dearest friend Jesus had on earth in human companionship, the two sisters did not believe that he'd bring him back from the dead. They laughed at him and he told them to go outside. He said, Jairus, you and mom, come on in. Peter, James, John, Jairus, and Jairus' wife follow the master into the sick room of the little girl. And we see in verses 41 and 42 this merciful miracle of resuscitation. Does it strike you as interesting that the miracle ministry of Jesus, essentially any miracle you go to, is an expression of Jesus' compassion and care for hurting mankind? He does not one time that's recorded give anyone a brand new chariot. Doesn't do it. He doesn't make a lot of shekels fall out from the sky. Doesn't mean that he couldn't have. What it means is when you catalog the miracles of Jesus, whether he's calming the seas, whether he's healing the withered hand, the lame leg, giving sight to blinded eyes, giving hearing to deaf ears, giving speech to those who cannot, to the dumb, as we call them, those who cannot speak, raising the dead by resuscitating life in them. The miracles of Jesus are merciful manifestations. When the psalmist writes Psalm 136, he's using a technique to remind himself and all of those who will hear this and sing this song. We have a contemporary equivalent in several different ways. One of them is a hymn I sang growing up. Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. That's the driving thought there. His steadfast love endures forever. The word steadfast love, as I understand it in the Hebrew, is a word ruhama, which is about finds its root, I think, in the womb. We have that kind of tender mercy from God shown through Jesus while he was among us during his ministry. They go into the room. Verses 41 and 42 say that he takes her by the hand, that little lifeless hand. Could have been in a folded position here when after she had died. Maybe it was by her side. And said to her, Talitha kumi. Kumi, I say arise. Little girl, arise. And immediately, Mark records, immediately the girl got up and began walking. Got up out of bed. Didn't go for a walk, but she began walking. We don't know what her affliction was and how long she had had it and what had hindered her from doing, but we do know this, that when she arose, she got up on her feet and started walking around in full possession of her physical capacities. She was 12. Like a lot of 12-year-old girls, if she's alert, she's not going to be still. And those there with him, Jairus, his wife, Peter, James, John, were immediately, see, she got up immediately. They were immediately overcome with awe. I'm in awe of you. They were filled with awe and wonder. These three disciples had not that many days ago been on a boat when a storm stirred up that was so powerful, so massive, And Peter and James and John were all fishermen, made their living casting their nets into the deep to catch large amounts of fish to sell them and make a living. They'd been on some angry seas, but they were in the boat, and when Jesus spoke, "Be quiet, be still." Who is this one? Who is this man that even the waves and the wind obey? Well, this takes to a whole different level here. That the dead hear his voice and rise. Brothers and sisters, when we read this, we dare not conclude, well, then that means that because of Jesus' power, I can get anything I want. I can get out of any jam I'm in. No, that's not what it means. What it means is he can. He has the power and should be trusted. And when it appears to us he's chosen not to, then we must trust him, continue to have faith, not give up on faith and start fearing and grieving and groaning and mumbling, but continue to believe. Stop fearing. Believe is the message he gives to Jairus. It's the message he gives to us today. We have a strange request that comes from him. He strictly, verse 43, he strictly charged them that no one should know this. Some commentators call this the messianic secret, that would do these great things and then keep, so don't tell anyone. And I told you before that there's a couple of times he does this in the Gospels and they go tell everybody. And can you say they were disobedient? What's driving this here? You cannot help. If you were one of the weeping and the wailing, if you were part of the community peering into the door of the house to say, how is it with the little girl? And she comes walking out. You cannot help but say something about it. You won't say, "Taken." She recovered suddenly. No. Jesus brought her back from the dead. What's driving this here? Because he tells the demoniac earlier in this chapter, go tell them what great things the Lord has done for you. He sends him as a missionary. He seems to want to silence these folks. The difference, and I believe this is a valid difference, is the Decapolis, where the demoniac lived, was a primarily Gentile region. Here we are in primarily Jewish regions. And Jesus was going to be made Messiah on their terms. And so that admonition that no one should know this is not gagging them to tell them lie when someone asks you, but a hindrance on people making him Messiah on their terms. He was not yet revealed. He begins to be revealed in the Mount of Transfiguration when this same Peter, James, and John will see him in almost a beatific reality with Moses and Elijah there. He's going to be revealed somewhat at the cross, though it's hard to look on, but he's really revealed in the resurrection from the dead. It's as if to say, much of this resuscitation. Don't go out and overdo this resuscitation. I'm going to give you much to make over. What do we learn from this? Jesus Christ, who focused, had a fixed focus on the cross. Peter shows us this as Mark writes his memoirs of this. He's headed to the cross as quickly as he can get there in terms of the timing of God. But he was never too busy to show mercy. That should take you and me and encourage us and lift our hearts up. Because see, Jesus is not today, if you can even use the word today, talking about where he is not now pressing toward the cross. He did that once for all. He died on that cross. He rose from the grave. Hebrews, which you've been studying in the Bible study time, says that he ever lives to make intercession for us. He prays for us at the right hand of the Father, where he is seated. And one day he will rise, and when he stands up and he rises, all the demons throughout all the earth will shriek and moan. Because when he comes back, he'll not come back to put demons into pigs. He will cast the devil and his angels and those who've been content to ignore who Jesus is, they will all be thrown into the lake of fire. But right now, he prays. His steadfast love continues for you and me and for many more. And we can say this with judgment day honesty to any sinner, to anyone who is hopeless, who's lost hope, who's given up. I want to tell you about a Savior whose love endures forever. When you discover his love for you, you will never have to worry about him changing his mind about that. His love endures forever. Even through our doubting, even through our falling, even through our failing. When we can't seem to endure much more than a day or two, his love endures forever. And he would say to us, like he said to Jairus, stop fearing, believe. And he does something else here to close this passage out. He told her to give her something to eat. Is there anyone you know who shows such compelling, consistent attention to detail when it comes to showing compassion to sons of Adam and daughters of Eve? I tell you, no. The big miracle, he resuscitates her, brings her back from the dead. The reason I say resuscitate is that she would die again in the course of time, just like Lazarus, who was resuscitated, would die again in the course of time. So it's not resurrection like he's going to experience, it's resuscitation, brought back to life. And yet the heart of compassion of Jesus for that family, for that little girl, even in the face of his admonition, don't tell anyone, you see the heart of compassion fulfilling itself when he says, give her something to eat. Feed the child. It'd been easy to get lost in the wonder of the miracle. But Jesus says, give her something to eat. There's a word for us here, brothers and sisters, as we close. We're entering the Thanksgiving season. We have so much for which to be thankful. May God help us to remember that and day by day rejoice in his goodness and say in our hearts and perhaps out loud, his steadfast love endures forever. His steadfast love that has found me, mercy, mercy, as Josh sang, as endless as the sea. May it provoke a hallelujah in our lives. And then a sensitivity that we not get caught up and lost in wonder, but that wonder in the face of God's grace shown to us in Jesus Christ will work itself out in being sure to feed those who need something to eat. That's the church on mission, as I understand it, to declare the glory of God. Us to glorify him, to enjoy him forever. He made us to love him, to love God. But he also made us to love one another. And he also made us to serve the world. Believe him to be the miracle-working God. Whatever you're facing today, whatever the professionals have said about your situation and your condition, believe Jesus to be the wonder-working Savior. Believe the Spirit whom he sent to indwell us and carry us home to heaven to be that Spirit who whispers to us, God is your Father. He wants to hear from you. He's tender toward you. And live in the light of that. And whenever you're inclined to fear, remember his words, stop fearing. Just believe. Just believe. Is it that simple? It is, because it's out of our hands. When we take it into our hands, we make it complicated. But it is that simple. Stop fearing, simply, only believe. I trust you, Lord. Whatever's coming, I trust you, Lord. Whatever this means, ultimately, I trust you, Lord. And then recount to one another the wonderful mercies of God shown to you in your journey, because we could all tell them. This miracle that took place in the backdrop of another miracle. I ask you, as we close, it's easy to be part of the religious crowd. There was a crowd there that day when that woman who had the issue of bleeding. Or simply walking with the crowd. Or have we touched him? Touched him in faith, believing he is able. Let's pray.